So if you look at, this has been, of course, said several times in this day or so we have been. So sustaining agriculture production involves minimizing impacts of adverse climate and also maximizing the favorable periods. So making effective use of climate information actually contributes to all the sustainable development goals, disaster risk reduction, as well as climate adaptation, as you have seen in many of the presenters earlier talking about this. So with this in mind, if we look at, I tried to put a broad schematic on factors which influence, and this is the sustenance of agriculture. If you have a line which is an ideal line going like this, then you have factors like, climate hazards, pollution, overuse of pesticides and chemicals, fertilizers, and loss of soil fertility, and so on, trying to bring the sustainability pathway down. But there are other things like minimizing hazard losses, minimizing chemical inputs, crop suitability, effective water management, and all these practices which actually try to put it back in the sustainable path. So if you look at all this, they all could be benefited by climate information. So how is that? We have seen it in some of the slides and presentations earlier. But if you look at the how, for example, scheduling irrigation based on rainfall forecasts, it can lead to water savings, power savings, soil nutrients retained, so many of the benefits which contribute to sustaining and building resilience and putting agriculture systems in a pathway which is more efficient. So if you go use climate information for effective spraying operations using weather forecasts, that will lead to lesser toxic chemicals in the systems, and also economic viability, effective spraying operations. And this is exactly what we find when we, after some of the climate field school, for example, if you do an evaluation of those climate field schools, many of the farmers report that these are the benefits which they were able to transform into economic benefits, actually. So this is all methods in which climate knowledge and information can put us back in a sustainable pathway. So climate outlooks based on crop choices, also this reduces inputs and more effectively planning the crop which is suitable for that particular season or that particular area. So again, there is also enhanced sensitivity of crop needs if you use effectively the past climate information to plan agriculture in a particular place. So here, there is also an important thing about knowing the agriculture history of a location. For example, one which comes to my mind is, if you look at southern India, where I come from, if you look at something like 17th century, they never grew 17 or before that, they were not into paddy cultivation. But right now, it's one of the biggest paddy cultivation area. So they were into hard millets and those kind of things. But then that point, there were a lot of water retention structures built, which were able to support paddy cultivation, and they went up to something like three crops in one season, whereas the climate actually of that place doesn't support such an intensive paddy cultivation. So what happened is, as you look at the agriculture history of the place, there is a strong need for irrigation systems. And when irrigation systems are stressed, that means if they have two or three bad rain seasons, so then you have to depend on groundwater. So then it results in a lot of excessive pumping of the groundwater, and that creates additional stress and also additional energy inputs into the system. So this is the kind of information we can gain, and also try to use that information of agriculture history to put systems back in more sustainable pathways, and also use effectively some of the choices which are emerging in the recent trends. For example, people are more health conscious, so there is a slight movement at least towards more healthy and maybe coarser cereals and so on. So such indicators can be taken up, and you can do a similar kind of table for many of the sectors which are connected to food security, for example, water, health, or disaster risks. So going further in the discussion, like yesterday there was one sort of question about how will farmers relate to such weather information if it's very general. For example, this is an kind of story or anecdote from one of our field visits work in Myanmar. So when we were working there, we just stopped and randomly met some farmers, and one of them actually we asked through translators that how can you use seasonal information? If we just tell you whether it's going to be normal monsoon or above normal monsoon or below normal monsoons, but the farmers themselves are very, you know, very much aware, because it is their crop and it is their situation. They are quite aware. So they, it was surprising for us that they came up with a very, very sort of articulated answer that in a, you know, a farmer who we talked to had about 4 acres of farm, and he said it needs, you know, pumping for a whole day, which consumes 2 gallons of fuel to irrigate that 4 acres of farm. So in an above normal wet season, paddy crop, if he cultivates paddy crop, it will require only 2 to 3 irrigations. So he said, if you say above normal, I have to only plan for 2 to 3 irrigations and that amount of money and all those things. So, but if you say below normal or a dry season, he has to go for at least 15 irrigations. So he will think about whether to plant paddy or something else. So if it's a, just a normal season, only 9 times. So what I'm saying is farmers have sufficient kind of know-how at their local scale on what they want to do, and it's their crop. And the enabling system or empowering system has to be created to deliver to them proper climate information, which can help them to decide and also understand and use it, not just as a piece of information, as knowledge. So that is what came out in many of the press. Like yesterday, there were some discussions about the climate field schools, for example. So that is what is happening in climate field schools. I'll talk something about it later too. So actually, all this work started with, one of the main milestones for this work, which we started, was through a ECFAO project. In fact, we worked with the FAO regional office in Bangkok. So this was a project on linking information and decision making to improve food security. So it was looking at all the kind of information, including market information and everything. So, but we were only implementing the part. So this project was in the Greater Mekong sub-region, covering the countries Cambodia, Laos, PDR, and Myanmar. And we were looking at only the enhanced utility of seasonal climate forecasts and managing climate change risk. So that was the part which RIMES was involved in. And within this, there were 2 activities. And one was a monsoon forum, which some of our earlier presenters presented as they are also like national climate outlook forums. So monsoon forums for enhancing the utility of seasonal forecasts, and also there was another component which was on managing climate risks. So when we completed the project, which ran from 2011-12, 2 years, less than 2 years actually, so the independent evaluation, when it was done, these were the main points which emerged, that in the field of climate information, major achievement of the project was in bringing together users and producers of information in the monsoon forums. So the interface part has been stressed, and it came out very clearly in the independent evaluation. And potentially this process could lead to tailored applications of forecast. This is the next step, where you go from the National Climate Outlook forums to more specific contexts. So I will talk about that. And also, in terms of linking information and decision making, the climate work has the most potential impact. So this was a conclusion of that particular project. And of course, there are other things like ASEAN food security information system to be strengthened and so on. So this is, again, it puts emphasis on the need to create interfaces and use those interfaces to contextualize the delivery of climate information so that they can be effectively acted on. just not in a very general sense. So again, this is the chain which we have been talking about. So you have at one end of the chain generators of climate information like the National Meteorological Services. We work with mostly work in all the countries through the National Meteorological Services so that the whole system is in an operational framework. It may take time, but it is within the system of operations so that it is when the project gets over, it is sustained as a part of the system with their own initiatives and in-country work. So you have all the steps. So you have the first, which is generation of the forecasts and predictions, and then their processing so that it becomes a product which can be actually acted on and people can use it for decision making, and the whole process of creating an interface to have these connections so that the whole system works, and also have a feedback so that the improvements go on to further improve the generation part or the way it is packaged or its processing and so on. So climate information creating systems, effectively linking them with the with generation at one end and the users at the other end through various processes is one of the main institutional connect which we look at in these kind of projects. So now coming to a sort of a framework which we are looking at, the climate services framework. If you look at from the World Meteorological Organization point of view, we have global centers like the Tokyo Climate Center, Beijing Climate Center, or many other international centers like ECMWF, which produce products, generate a lot of high resolution and very state-of-the-art products. So these are available at a global level. Then you have regional level, regional centers which are working to process this data and make it more regionally relevant. And then you have systems like the Regional Climate Outlook Forum, which processes this information and brings together in a participatory fashion all the meteorological agencies within the region. Like, for example, we have the ASEAN COF, ASEAN Climate Outlook Forum. We have the South Asian Seasonal Climate Outlook Forum, which is the SASCOF, which happens in South Asia, and ASEAN COF happens in Southeast Asia. So there, the meteorological services come together and in a participatory fashion decide what is the best kind of forecast for the region and how they can align with this regional forecast and make the best use of the products available from the global center. So these are the components of the global framework for climate services which we are talking about. So at the national level, we have the National Meteorological Services, and they host the National Climate Outlook Forums or the Monsoon Forums, which our colleague from BMKG described yesterday and some other colleagues also described. So we have these processes which act as sectoral interfaces, and they are now being held in a very, very regular fashion in most countries. So that enables a regular interface between the producers of climate information and the users of climate information at a national level. But you could always have, you know, various formulations at subnational levels and so on. So this in itself is a starting point. So it's a starting point for more specific climate services which can be delivered in a tailored fashion. So these are only you know, first level of use of the information in a more general way. So then you have these kind of systems backed up by creating awareness and you know, the like the farmers field schools or the other sectors also, like health sector or the water sector. They need to be exposed, and you know, what's the how do you understand a probability forecast? How can you give confidence levels and so on? So this is how we put together the whole framework for climate services at a global to national level. So then one of the things which RIMES has been involved in since February 2016 is we are implementing the WMO Global Framework, GFCS project, for the South Asian region in about 8 countries. So we started doing it in February 2016. So some of the work which we did under this project, I'll describe in a few slides. So one of the main task one of this cluster of work which we did for GFCS was to have support the regional climate outlook forums in South Asia. So we started with earlier, there were climate outlook forums were only once just for the summer monsoon season, but the winter season rains are also important for some of the southern countries like Sri Lanka, Maldives, and also in the northern regions, northern India, and also Pakistan, and so on. So we started having the winter regional climate outlook forum in addition to the summer climate outlook forum, SASCOF. So this was a session which was held last year in Myanmar. So now this year we will be having it in Maldives in end of September. So these kind of forums are important in bringing together the regional products and also having consensus opinion among the meteorological services. And also they have, you know, along with that climate services users forum, so that user sectors can be exposed to these kind of products which are available at regional scale. So in addition to that, we do have the national climate outlook forums, which are the which are mostly held at national level, bringing together about which I've already talked about. So in the task cluster two, it's basically we devised modules and also outreach for particularly, of course, this is about agriculture sector. So like the climate field schools for farmers. We also had awareness programs for the other sectors like the health sector and the water sector in various countries where we are implementing this climate services project. So the last task cluster is, of course, on how to move forward from the interface you created in the monsoon National Climate Outlook Forum to further contextualize into various sectors the and enhance the use of climate information. So basically, we were working on decision support systems in water sector, agriculture sector, health, and fisheries. So these were in different countries. So I will talk about water sector and the agriculture sector, where we have made a little bit of progress in two countries. The water sector, we worked in Sri Lanka, and agriculture was more in India. So this the water sector project actually is for a reservoir management system using climate information and weather information. So because most of the sectors are not even using the weather information on a regular scale, so when we start building these systems, you have to start with the weather system, weather forecast, and then integrate the seasonal predictions too. So this was a basin based in the southern Sri Lanka, which is a relatively dry area, and it also has a huge command area for irrigated agriculture, mostly paddy cultivation. So this is the area and blown up, and this is called the Kirindi Oya Basin. So that's where the project was set up. And actually, the way the project was set up was, it was an outcome of one of the National Outlook, Climate Outlook Forums, or the Monsoon Forums as it's called in Sri Lanka, where the Department of Irrigation was one of the regular participants. So they were using some of the forecasts provided, seasonal outlooks provided by the Department of Meteorology, which was hosting the Monsoon Forum. So using that as a entry point, they were active and proactive participants. So we started engaging with them, and then we had a project initiation meeting in May 2016, and that's where they themselves, in a participatory fashion, it was identified this particular basin, and they said that they would like to see a test case implemented in this basin using the climate and weather forecast inputs. So we had a series of activities there. In August, we had a survey meeting and initial inception meeting. And after that, we had a familiarization training for the reservoir managers who will use this system. And then we actually built the system and handed over last month for beta testing. So the system itself, I'm not going into all the details, but it starts with the weather and climate data, which is the primary input, and then it goes into a hydrological modeling framework, which in this case is the HMS, which is one of the very popular open source model, hydrological model, which actually estimates the flows into the reservoir taking these forecasts. And then there is a reservoir management model, which is the water evaluation and planning tool. It's called the WEEP. And this is, again, sort of more or less open source. And so this whole setup is put on a web-based system so that the forecast and climate information is used to estimate the reservoir water levels. And the WEEP system is used to enable the reservoir managers to operate the water management in a manner which is informed by the climate information and weather information. So this is an operational system on a web-based system, and it's runs on the RIMS server, but they can access it using a password-protected system. And they are currently testing it. So it has various modules within it to verify and to know what kind of inflows are going to be there into the reservoir, and what will be the level of the water in the reservoir, and how they can manage further using that forecast information. So this is one of the projects. And then the other one which we did in India was it's called the Specialized Expert System for Agrometeorological Early Warning. So it is acronym SESME. And basically, it again starts with a weather forecast component, and also it could be plugged in like monthly and seasonal outlooks. So then it has a forecast translation part, which is basically a very simple approach. It has the main crop weather calendars of the location where which this tool is being applied. It is currently set up for all of India. And the forecast product actually comes from the Indian Meteorological System operational model. At 11 kilometers resolution, they have the model set up. And also other products from ECMWF and other seasonal forecasts available from the Institute of Tropical Meteorology, they are used. And then the forecast generates bulletins which can be reviewed by the expert reviewers, both at the meteorological department as well as the agriculture department, who are collaborating within this project. So they, in turn, the agriculture department, actually, there is a access given to block-level agriculture extension officers who are also trained on how to interpret and use this tool, which is, again, a web-based tool. So they are presented with various, you know, based on thresholds, what kind of adverse weather or agronomical operations related weather, which is essential for them, is presented in a sort of bulletin. And they can use that and combine it with their local information and go to the farmers to advise them. So the farmers, again, are bottom up. They have some training already through the climate field schools, so they are already in a position to receive this information and to act on them. So this completes the whole process. It's not perfect, but this is a process in place which will take evolve over time, but nevertheless it is within the system. So it is the main collaborating agencies in both, in the case of Sri Lanka as well as India, are the meteorological department, the agriculture department, and all the systems linked to them. So in case of Sri Lanka, it's the Department of Irrigation, Department of Agriculture, and the Department of Meteorology. So this is the way we are trying to operationalize and mainstream climate information to manage risks. And most of these modules and things are built on open source, and they are also scalable, as well as components could be plugged in and out. So if we customize a certain system using the IMD forecast, it can be plugged out, and some other operational forecast can be plugged in. So when we want to replicate in other countries, there is a turnaround time is very less, and also the cost involved will be less. So now there is a significant interest in this kind of a system, so we are trying to sort of implement it in some other countries too. So this is the sort of a screenshot of the Indian AgroQuant system. So this is again customized, and they are going to start using it soon. So we have just handed over it. So this is, so if you look at the system, within the system, there are forecast components of different times, lead times. Then there is a dynamic crop information part, which is, which can be uploaded within in a spatially distributed fashion. So they can log in and upload the crop which is important for a certain region. This can be done in a distributed fashion. And then also there is the data streams which are coming into the system include the real-time observations and also the forecast streams from the different lead times. So this can actually, this drives a verification page. So your forecasts are also being shown as, you know, besides what was the real weather realized and what was the forecast. So there is a page which shows the verification, which gives the forecaster or the reviewer some kind of confidence on how the performance of the forecast has been. So similarly, we have various components. I will not go into all the details, but it has got validation of information and also systems to disseminate it through various sources like email, SMS, and so on. So, and feedback mechanism through the website itself, as well as there is a mobile app form of this whole application, which can be downloaded. That part is actually operationalized for one of the systems we did earlier for Myanmar. So these are the kind of systems which we are working on to deliver climate services and actually connect the generator to the final users of climate information. So finally, this was just the discussion was on one sector. But when you look at more holistic, take a holistic look, then if you have food security, then you have factors like availability, access, utilization, and stability. So we need to, like many other presentations, increase agriculture production, reduce post-harvest losses. So storage, transport, and all of them are in some way affected by climate. And again, in access, food prices, securing livelihoods, and all these are connected again to climate. And then in terms of utilization, you have health and anticipated preparedness for disease outbreaks. So that part is also covered when you go into this whole thing from a food security point of view. And then about stability, we get into issues of disaster risks and extremes. So this provides a very ideal entry point to work on a range of sectors which are all benefiting from climate information. So that is not only agriculture, but including animal husbandry, as my earlier presenter said. Of course, we have other sectors like water health and disaster risk reduction. So, but the information itself has different levels at which it can be used. So if you have something like global food availability, there are controls which are more or less planetary scale controls like El Nino and so on. And then at national level, you will have controls on national food production due to factors like delayed monsoon. So the seasonal forecast and the situation of drought and so on are important at a national level, but when you go into sub-national level, like households, household food access, so then you come to really localized scale vagaries of weather, both the weather and climate. So these could impact health and nutrition. So the whole thing has layers of, layers in which decision making will be informed by climate information. So in conclusion, of course, we have this, range of products now increasingly available from the climate and weather community. From the National Meteorological Services, you have the historical climate data and the range of products right from days to years in ahead for like climate projections. So all this would be pivotal to inform food security and all the sectors linked to it. Food security is, as I said, linked to health, water, and other key areas where climate information could be useful. Of course, past knowledge and emerging trends, both social and technological, as we have seen in many of the climate smart and technology intensive presentations, all of them need to be innovatively balanced and used on how we will proceed further, and all these opportunities leveraged for the transitional change which we want to bring.